I am your father. You deliberately disobeyed me. Everything the light touches is our kingdom. Hello, reformed mythologist Nate Morgan Locke here. I'd like to take a few minutes to talk to you about Lord Vader, or Star Wars. Now, if ever there was a franchise story, it's this one. And perhaps the true father of franchise storytelling is George Walton Lucas Jr. He was an author. Actually, no, he was a filmmaker. Remember, kids, films aren't books. You can make a film into a book, but it's not the same, is it? Films are fun and exciting with their moving pictures and lightsaber noises. But books are boring. Just squiggles on a page, and most of them don't even have pictures. You have to concentrate to make the story move, but with a film, it's just right there on the screen in front of you. It just keeps going while you eat another packet of crisps. So how did George Lucas make these Star Wars films? Why did they have such a profound cultural impact? And why did the story of Skywalker need to be made into so many of them? The answer to that final question is money. But in this video, I want to show you that the basis of Star Wars is mythological, psychological, and perhaps most weirdly, historical. It's also hilariously inconsistent at points, but we won't let that stop our fun.
Only Imperial stormtroopers are so precise.
So in the first video in this series of You Can Buy the Lunchbox stories, I argued that Harry Potter was, taken on its own terms, a deeply Christian story. It's such a controversial topic that there were Facebook comments about it. But here, I'm kind of going to argue that all stories are Christian stories.
I got a bad feeling about this.
So how am I going to do that? Well, by building on the idea of sub-creation that we heard about from dear Mr. Johnny Tolkien in the Lord of the Rings video. There's reality, the primary world in which we live and move and have our being, and then there's play, the secondary world of our fictional stories. So what about this primary world we're living in then? One way to answer the question of reality is to study what people think inside their heads. And for the last 150 years, we've been analysing what goes on inside psychos through the study of psychoanalysis. You've no doubt heard of Sigmund Freud, the bespectacled and bearded Austrian who believed that the story which made most sense of the real world was the one about Oedipus, the king who was abandoned as a baby but returned to fulfil a prophecy by solving the riddle of the Sphinx, murdering his father and sleeping with his mother. She then hanged herself, and he gouged out his own eyes. I'll save my reformed mythologist study of that particular story for another day. But how does this relate to Star Wars? Great question. Thanks for asking. It's going to take a minute or two, but join me on a journey to a galaxy far, far away, and we'll find out. One of Sigmund Freud's friends, Freud friend, you got friends in me, was a Swiss man named Carl Jung, who stumbled across some similarities in myths across different cultures. He developed an idea called the collective unconscious, including his own theories about archetypes and personalities. We could also call them figures of the imagination. Some people think he was a big deal.
And so these figures of the imagination can reveal the structure of reality to you. And that's what happened with Jung, and that's what he described in the Red Book, and that was what permeated his psychology, a psychology that was based on the presupposition that the fundamental archetypal structures of religious belief were not pathological, not deceitful, not protective in some delusional sense against the fear of death, but quite the contrary. The very stories that enabled us to move forward as confident human beings in the face of chaos itself. And it's conceivable, I think perhaps probable, that nothing more important conceptually happened in the 20th century than that.
Quite the claim. You tracking so far? Of course you are. That was Canadian psychologist and cultural phenomenon Jordan Peterson. He's a fan of Carl Jung, and he was just saying that our deepest stories help us to understand the real world and know how to live in it. groovy. Let's move on. Well, an American named Joseph Campbell was also a Carl Jung fanboy. He liked those ideas of figures of the imagination and deep stories and all that. Anyway, in 1949, Campbell wrote a book called The Hero with a Thousand Faces. It's a book comparing the deepest stories known to man, comparative mythology. It's fine to say comparative mythology. And in it, he argues that the myths share a basic plot structure he called the hero's journey. He also refers to it as the monomyth, which is actually a much cooler word. Monomyth. There's a word to keep your spirits up in a particularly slow-moving queue at the supermarket. Anyway, here's how Campbell sums up the hero's journey. A hero ventures forth from the world of common day into a region of supernatural wonder. Fabulous forces are there encountered, and a decisive victory is won. The hero comes back from this mysterious adventure with the power to bestow boons on his fellow man. We're all bestowing boons, aren't we? I bestowed 3 boons last week alone. Tell you what, why don't we map out the hero's journey, and let's do it with bits of Star Wars. See, I told you we'd get back to the point eventually. So it starts off with the hero at home. He's doing his regular farm boy thing, and it's all very once upon a time. Or rather, a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. Anyway, he then receives what is called the call to adventure, which he usually refuses because it sounds far too difficult, uncomfortable, or intimidating, and he's far too busy watching Disney Plus. The call to adventure is not to be confused with the call of nature, which should our hero refuse, he's very likely to find himself in difficulty, uncomfortable, and, if not intimidated, certainly needing a change of underwear.
When you gotta go, you gotta go.
Anyway, the hero will meet a wise mentor. Maybe he's called Obi-Wan Kenobi. Soon after, he'll need to cross the threshold into the unknown. Into the unknown. That's right, Frozen 2 is also a proper hero's journey, but we won't get into that right now. But you can check out the Popcorn Parenting episode if you need to. Having crossed the threshold, the hero is likely to find assistance from various characters, sometimes a Wookiee and a space hustler who's a little less innocent and a little more cynical than the hero. He'll no doubt do a bit of training with his mentor roundabout now, often in a pleasing montage style. And that way, he'll be ready to approach the inmost cave. Ooh, this is where things get dark and scary. He'll then go through the ordeal, or abyss, which probably means having to watch a Star Wars holiday special or something.
A day of harmony.
But should he overcome that death, he'll get hold of that boon,
blue,
so he has something to bestow later in the story. He's now leaving the unknown realm, returning to the known world through a resurrection. And now he's back from outer space, richer for the experience, so he can bestow those boons. Now, the reason why we need to use the hero's journey to get a handle on Star Wars is because George Walton Lucas was a big fan of Joseph Campbell. Here's George himself being interviewed by Bill Bradley on the radio show American Voices, way back in history, back in the year 2012.
How did Joseph Campbell affect your thinking when you were formulating the ideas?
Joe Campbell was a comparative mythologist, and the Joseph Campbell angle really came out of my anthropology classes when I was in college. Yeah, you know, I was very curious about the way societies work and why people do the things they do in a society, why they form their ideas. And I used to always think of mythology as a form of psychological archaeology. You're not just digging up pieces to look at them and try to figure out what is what's going on with the society. With mythology, you can actually understand the psychological underpinnings of what people actually were thinking, what they were afraid of, what they felt about their parents, what, you know, the real psychology of the whole thing. So that's what sort of started that whole process. And I had studied Joe Campbell. I continue to study Joe Campbell. And I really tried to take these psychological motifs from mythology all over the world. As a result, I was able to take ideas that go through all societies, through all the ages, and bring them down and put them into a razzle-dazzle Saturday matinee serial action-adventure film.
So, mythology is a form of psychological archaeology, says Lucas. And Star Wars is a kind of painting by numbers. So that's the theory, and it's produced a lot of success at the box office. But there are naysayers. Ooh, those naysayers. And this is what film director Guillermo del Toro, himself a box office success, has to say about the whole Campbellian story structure as basis for box office success thing. Our curse is that the film industry is 80% run by the half-informed. You have people who have read Joseph Campbell and Robert McKee, and now they're talking to you about the hero's journey, and you want to cut off their and stuff it in their mouth. Mr. Del Toro, that's quite enough. This is a family restaurant. Now, Del Toro's objection is not that the hero's journey is the wrong story structure, it's that he takes issue with the idea of story structure in the first place. And perhaps part of his cynicism is because the storytelling industry is not limited to the approved scripts and screenplays. It's also about the wannabes, the aspiring writers who want to read books, attend seminars, and watch YouTube channels that will help them write their own screenplay or novel.
Nice little story you're working on there, a big novel you've been working on for 3 years. Yeah? Got a compelling protagonist. Second 100 pages really keep the reader guessing what's going to happen. Some twists and turns. Little epilogue. Everybody learns the hero's journey isn't always a happy one.
Yeah, I look forward to reading it.
But whatever Guillermo says, George Lucas, the father of franchise storytelling, took the hero's journey and made it so commercially successful that half the men in the United States have at least one pair of Darth Vader pajamas. Now, I don't want to spend the rest of this video showing how the story beats of the Skywalker saga fit the pattern of the hero's journey. Other videos on this topic are available on this website. But here we're tracing the mythological, psychological, and yes, weirdly, historical basis for Star Wars. Let's think about persons and personalities. I wonder if you've ever found yourself being described as an INFJ, or an ISFP, or what's worse, an ENTP. Well, if you have, that's because the analytical psychology of Carl Jung wasn't only popular at the box office, but also at the regular office too. Mm-hmm. You see, employers wanted to understand their employees, and managers wanted to get a handle on team dynamics. Personality profiling is a big deal. It turns out that Carl Jung's theories of human personality were, in fact, the major influence on Myers and Briggs. Here's them here. Turns out they were a mother and daughter team. Don't pretend you saw that coming. Now, by answering a series of questions and remembering the four-letter result that defines who you are, you can find out which members of your favorite franchise share your personality. You can do this with Star Wars and laugh as you match with Emperor Palpatine, Wicket the Ewok, or Jar Jar Binks. Apparently, me and R2-D2 have a lot in common. But what's funny about this is that both cultural phenomena have the same origin, the analytical psychology of Carl Jung. Once you know where to fire your X-Wing's torpedoes, taking down a Death Star is surprisingly straightforward.
The battle station is heavily shielded and carries a firepower greater than half the Starfleet. Its defenses are designed around a direct, large-scale assault. A small, one-man fighter should be able to penetrate the outer defense.
Pardon me for asking, sir, but what good are stunt fighters going to be against that?
Well, the Empire doesn't consider a small one-man fighter to be any threat, or they'd have a tighter defense. An analysis of the plans provided by Princess Leia has demonstrated a weakness in the battle station. The approach will not be easy. You're required to maneuver straight down this trench and skim the surface to this point. The target area is only 2 meters wide. It's a small thermal exhaust port right below the main port. The shaft leads directly to the reactor system. A precise hit will start a chain reaction, which should destroy the station. Only a precise hit will set up a chain reaction. The shaft is ray-shielded, so you'll have to use proton torpedoes.
That's impossible, even for a computer.
It's not impossible. It's the bullseye womp rats in my T-16 back home. They're not much bigger than 2 meters.
Then man your ships, and may the Force be with you.
I do love a battle briefing scene. All that chunky exposition stuck in a blender and served with a splash of characterization.
Nice.
But what if, instead of getting to the core of a Death Star, you wanted to get to the heart of the Star Wars mythos, and then cause a chain reaction to blow the minds of the fans by showing that Star Wars relies on a deeply Christian theology? So how do you get to the heart of the Star Wars story? Okay, what's the most profound scene in Star Wars? That's right, the Luke and Vader lightsaber fight from The Empire Strikes Back. And why is that scene the most profound? Because of this bit.
I am your father. Search your feelings. You know it to be true.
No! No!
I probably should have given a spoiler alert. Sorry about that. The beating heart of the Star Wars story is the relationship between a father and a son. Since this scene forms the central point of the original trilogy, and that original trilogy is the chronological center point of the trilogy of trilogies, the Skywalker paternity question is fundamental to the saga. The Christian view of reality says that a father-son relationship is fundamental. It shows us the God who is Father, Son, and Spirit. Let's look at these Bible verses pointing to the very core of reality. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open, and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and will glorify it again. Now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began." Now, a great popularizer of the hero's journey has been Dan Harmon, creator of, amongst other things, the Rick and Morty cartoon for grown-ups and the six seasons and a movie situation comedy, Community. In Community, Harmon wrote a character named Abed. Perhaps the ultimate pop culture nerd and franchise fan, in this scene, he's talking to his friend Shirley about making her an evangelistic video for her church.
Shirley, I read the New Testament.
The whole thing?
You know, being raised by TV and movies, I always thought that Jesus just walked on water and told people not to have abortions, but it's so much cooler than that. He was like E.T., Edward Scissorhands, and Marty McFly combined. Mm-hmm. I would love to make a Jesus movie.
Oh, Abed, that's wonderful. What do you think we should do? It needs to be cool and addictive, like that video of the kitten falling asleep.
Absolutely. But the story's been told to death, so I want to approach it in a new way. We need a Jesus movie for the post-postmodern world.
Like Jesus as a rapper?
No. I want to tell the story of Jesus from the perspective of a filmmaker exploring the life of Jesus.
That sounds very appealing to filmmakers.
See, in the filmmaker's film, Jesus is a filmmaker trying to find God with his camera. But then the filmmaker realizes that he's actually Jesus and he's being filmed by God's camera. And it goes like that forever in both directions, like a mirror in a mirror, because all of the filmmakers are Jesus and all of their cameras are God. And the movie's called Abed. All caps. Filmmaking. Beyond film. A meta film. My masterpiece.
I don't like it.
Well, that's okay. You know, you're reacting the way the world did to Jesus.
I'm reacting the way the world does to movies about making movies about making movies. I mean, come on, Charlie Kaufman, some of us have work in the morning, damn.
So according to Abed, the person of Jesus is E.T., Edward Scissorhands, and Marty McFly combined. A powerful, and let's be honest, utterly terrifying image. But is Jesus just one of the hero's thousand faces? Just one more fictional fan favorite? Just one more myth? No. No, he isn't. Let's hear friend of the show, C.S. Lewis. Now, as myth transcends thought, incarnation transcends myth. The heart of Christianity is a myth which is also a fact. The old myth of the dying God, without ceasing to be myth, comes down from the heaven of legend and imagination to the earth of history. It happens at a particular date, in a particular place, followed by definable historical consequences. We pass from a Balder or an Osiris dying nobody knows when or where to a historical person crucified, it is all in order, under Pontius Pilate. By becoming fact, it does not cease to be myth, and that's the miracle. And the incarnation of the eternal Son of God is not a deus ex machina, an arbitrary story event that nobody could see coming. It's not a random quantum leap into a strange body to do a nice thing and then head off again without context or explanation. No. The birth of the Messiah comes about through a carefully unfolded historical plan, developed intentionally through the generations from the very beginning. We turn, of course, to the Hebrew word toledot. 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 It means these are the generations of, or something like that, and it's used as a sort of chapter heading through the book of Genesis. These are the generations of Adam. These are the generations of Noah. These are the generations of Abraham, and so on. The birth of Jesus is eucatastrophic, of course. He's born of a virgin. But it's also the telos, or goal, it's fine to say goal, of the genealogies of the Old Testament. The lists of obscure names punctuated with the word begat, which cause people to struggle when they sit down to read the Bible all the way through. History is genealogical, and it matters. This was probably why the backstory of Rey was so controversial in the final trilogy. Ha, final. She started off as a mysterious, super-gifted, but lonely lady on Jakku. But Rey as a Palpatine? Really? We're just resurrecting original trilogy characters whenever we like, are we? Maybe it's because this is franchise storytelling, and we need to bring in the moneymakers and feed parasitically upon the reputation of legacy characters, so there's no consequences to any actions and no one ever really dies, and there's actually a multiverse and alternative timelines, and everything that had weight and emotional density in previous films can just be undone. I wonder what's driving all this. Now, maybe that's a cynical perspective on these much-loved stories. They're great, if you like that sort of thing. And perhaps I'm taking the whole thing far too seriously and should just chill out and let people enjoy what they enjoy. Okay, fine. But you might just want to test yourself by taking a break from your favorite franchises every now and again, just to prove that you can. Suspend your subscription for a month. Take a Sabbath rest. There is no such thing as must-see TV. Media is optional. But in a strange way, the J.J. Abrams course correction of Episode 9, The Rise of Skywalker, makes sense. Rey had to have some background, didn't she? Star Wars is meant to be a coherent, interwoven narrative with its own consistency, and we couldn't abide Rian Nothing is Sacred Johnson and his iconoclastic foray into the Star Wars universe. He had grizzled, misanthropic, embittered Luke Skywalker toss his old lightsaber away like it was no biggie. I suppose in the storytelling crisis, when you need to make more money from lunchbox sales, legacy characters can be burned for fuel. But some people were excited to have Rey, a random inhabitant of Jakku, turn out to be a Force genius. Her midichlorians were off the scale, and so she went to find Luke to learn from a Jedi. But of course, when Kathleen Kennedy and J.J. Abrams made The Rise of Skywalker, the decision to have a daughter of Palpatine identify as a Skywalker actually makes good mythological sense. Star Wars is a story about broken families, shameful lineage, and embarrassing ancestry. But it also insists upon a redemptive story arc. Much like the real world. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And how does that redemption work? Through adoption. The message of the gospel is that Palpatines can become Skywalkers. Not because they arbitrarily choose to, or they earned the right by having enough midichlorians or embraced the lighter side of an impersonal force, but because it's a boon bestowed upon them by the hero. Not the one with 1,000 faces, but the one who entered our flesh and blood history, Star Wars. Please remember, media consumption is optional. You are under no obligation to read these books, watch these films, or buy these pajamas. I'm Reformed mythologist Nate Morgan Locke. You've been watching Speak Life. I'm glad you were here.